السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. كنت في request brothers, can you please come close together? Those who are not in need of the walls, not those brothers, come please come closer. And the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم would sit in the company of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم for the sake of learning علم and knowledge. Then they would be sitting so close that if a blanket was to be spread over their heads, then one could not tell where someone is sitting and someone is not sitting. There would be no dip between them. And they would be sitting with such attention to the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if the birds would come and perch on their heads, and they would not be able to tell if it is a stone, it is a human. You must pay attention to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana lihada wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah wa akmala lana deenana وأتم علينا نعمته ورضي لنا الإسلام دينا. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا محمد عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وجنوده وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تعالى في محكم تنزيله بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، إن إبراهيم كان أمة، صدق الله العظيم. وقال تعالى في مقام آخر، واذكر في الكتاب إبراهيم إنه كان صديقا نبيا، إذ قال لأبيه يا أبت لم تعبد ما لا يسمع ولا يبصر ولا يغني عنك شيئا، يا أبت إني قد جاءني من العلم ما لم يأتك فاتبعني أهلك صراط سويا، صدق الله العظيم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، أوثق الإيمان الحب في الله والبغض في الله، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام، جا زندگی مدینے تجھوں کے ہوا کے لا، جا زندگی مدینے تجھوں کے ہوا کے لا، شاید حضور ہم سے خفا ہے منا کے لا، کچھ ہم بھی اپنا چہرے فاتح سوار لے، کچھ ہم بھی اپنا چہرے فاتح سوار لے، ابو بکر سے کچھ آئین عشق و وفا کے لا، دنیا بہت ہی تنگ مسلمان پہ ہو گئی، دنیا بہت ہی تنگ مسلمان پہ ہو گئی، فاروق کے زمانے کے کچھ نقشے اٹھا کے لا، محروم کر دیا ہمیں جن سے نگاہ نے، محروم کر دیا ہمیں جن سے نگاہ نے، عثمان سے وہ زاویے شرم و حیا کے لا، مغرب میں مارا مارا نہ پھر اے غدائے علم، مغرب میں مارا مارا نہ پھر اے غدائے علم، دروازے علی سے یہ خیرات جا کے لا، باطل سے دب رہی ہے امت رسول کی، باطل سے دب رہی ہے امت رسول کی، منظر حسین سے کچھ کرب و بلا کے لا. If you look, then you may be aware that at the beginning of each century, the socialists have sat together, the sociologists have sat together, and they have made predictions. And the previous century, the prediction which they made was that the century would be the battle, not a physical battle, but the battle of ideas, of color and of race, between white and black, and between ethnicity. And at the beginning of this century, in the year 2000, when the sociologists got together and they made a prediction for the next century, for the century which we are currently in, they said the battle and the ideas which shall contradict, and at the end of the century, the decision which shall be made shall be, and the battle shall be, the argument shall be between God and no God. And a few days ago, on the 15th of October, in Geneva, there was an international conference. And to this conference, many philosophers, theologians, scientists, scholars, religious members of societies of different religions were called to this meeting. And the discussion of this meeting was with regards to God and science, the existence of a creator, of an omnipotent supreme being, and that of science, and whether these two things are compatible or incompatible. And the city of Oxford is internationally known for its university. At the same time, it is also internationally known for one of the most notorious atheists in the world. You may have heard of him. He is also a lecturer at the University of Oxford. And he was also invited to this meeting in Geneva. And in this meeting, if I remember correctly, his name is Richard Dawkins.
Dawkins,
sorry. And he was also invited to this meeting. The reason why I have started with this introduction is because if you were to look at the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam, then you'll find that Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he came into this world, the world at that time was full of shirk, of polytheism, of ascribing partners with Allah Azza wa Jal. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith that every child, kullu mawludin, every child that is born, yuladu ala al-fitrah, is born on fitrah, on nature. Fitrah does not mean Islam, it means nature. So if a child was to be left without any interference from any other being, there was no human, there were no parents of them to make them Christians or Jews or Hindus or Muslims or any other religion. The child was to be left by itself with no interference. Then this child will come onto fitrah, onto nature, and nature is the acceptance of La ilaha illallah. That there is none worthy of worship except Allah Azza wa Jal. That there is only one creator. And this is a fact, and this is something which every person, if they were not influenced by external factors, they would all come to the same conclusion. Ibrahim alayhi salam in his time, he also came to this conclusion that despite the society surrounding me, despite all of them ascribing partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, however, he came to the conclusion that there must be only one God, there must be only one Lord, only one Creator, and only one Supreme Being, the All-Powerful, the Creator, the Omnipotent, and the only one who has no partner, the one who is absolute in his power and his might and his wisdom, who is running the system of the universe. And all the prophets, whenever they came into this world, despite the societies being full of jahiliyyah, being full of ignorance, being full of polytheism, or the complete denial of an existence of a creator, they all came to this conclusion that there is none worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his society would go to the cave of Hira to worship Allah alone, despite the whole community being full of polytheists. Ibrahim alayhi salam, at the age younger than 16, he understood the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then his message is mentioned in the Quran. And the Quran, like was mentioned before, does not narrate stories as once upon a time, a few thousand years ago, there lived a man by the name of Ibrahim. He was born in the area of modern day Palestine, Babylon, or the greater Sham. It does not go in a story as we read in storybooks. But Allah, apart from the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, which is in chronological order, every other mention of the Prophet is not as a chronological order. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whenever the time came in the stage of life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah revealed a certain event which took place in the previous Prophet, a certain happening, so as to advise and so as to help the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the stage which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was facing at that time. So these stories and this incident of Ibrahim alayhi salam is mentioned in different places of the Quran. The Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam is mentioned in more than 73 verses of the glorious Quran, in 25 surah chapters of the glorious Quran, and in Surah Maryam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he explains the scene and the scenario when Ibrahim alayhi salam at the tender age of 16 or below addresses his father once he has come to the conclusion of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he addresses his father, like I recited before you, yes, يَا أَبَتِ لِمَ تَعْبُدُ مَا لَا يَسْمَعُ وَلَا يُبْصِرُ وَلَا يُغْنِي عَنْكَ شَيْئًا. That, oh my beloved father, why do you worship that which cannot hear, which cannot see, which cannot benefit you in any way, which cannot cause you any harm, nor cause you any benefit? Why is it that you worship idols made out of stone? His father Azar, not only did he worship idols, his father Azar used to make idols from his, carve the idols from his own hands, and he used to sell them. Ibrahim alayhi salam is giving da'wah, and the call is to his father. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is below the age of 16. From here we learn an important point, that whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed someone with knowledge, and when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given someone an understanding and insight into the deen, then the person should be giving the da'wah and inviting towards the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the person, it does not depend on his age, on his status in society, on his background, or on his race, but it depends on his ilm, as can be seen from the following verse. Ibrahim alayhi salam did not say that you are older than me, therefore I shall follow you. No, he did not say that, no, you have so many years of experience, you have lived in the world for decades, you are much older than me, you should have much more intelligence, so therefore I may be wrong. But no, Ibrahim alayhi salam said to his father, Ya abati inni qad ja'ani min al-ilmi ma lam ya'tik fattabi'ni. That, oh my father, such knowledge has come to me which has not come to you. Ibrahim alayhi salam is addressing his father. He says, such knowledge has come to me which has not come to you, therefore follow me. The son of 16 is telling the father that follow me, because I have some knowledge which has not come to you. From this we learn that the leaders, the people who must be followed, are those who have the knowledge of the Quran and Sunnah, those who are the scholars, and those who have the ilm of Nubuwa, and those who are the inheritors of the Prophet alayhi wa salatu wa salam. So here Ibrahim alayhi salam is telling his father that follow me, fattabi'ni, follow my way, follow my call to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains how Ibrahim alayhi salam said, oh my beloved father, oh my beloved father, do not follow the footsteps of shaytan, of the devil. Thereafter he said, oh my father, I am warning you of a terrible punishment. From this we also learn that the scholars who stand up and they speak to the people and they warn them of the punishment, they're not just standing here just to scare everybody, but this is the way of the Prophet, that they warn the people that I am warning you, there is a terrible punishment if you don't follow the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you don't follow the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a terrible punishment awaits. Therefore I am warning you to follow the way so that you can be saved from the punishment. So here Ibrahim alayhi salam also tells his father that follow my way or else a terrible punishment avails in the hereafter. Thereafter see the response of the father. The father says to Ibrahim alayhi salam that you now have a few choices. Why and how dare you come to me, tell me to leave the way I have been following for so many years, and order me to leave the way of my forefathers, and order me to follow you, whereas I am your father and you are my son. I give you a few choices. Either you stop your message and you leave the home, you stop calling me towards your way and you leave the home, or I shall kill you and stone you to death. These are the words of the father to the son. From this you can understand the difference between kufr and iman, between belief and disbelief, that the father, because of his disbelief, has gone to such extent against his son because of his belief, that the father is ready to kill the son because of this device. Now what is the answer to Ibrahim, of Ibrahim alayhi salam to his father? His father said, I shall kill you and stone you, or you leave my home and go, I don't want to see your face. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he left the home and he said, remember, he is 16 years old, he said to his father, he is leaving the home, he is sent out from his home. He said, Salamun alayk. He told his father, oh my father, peace be upon you. His father said, I'm going to kill you and stone you to death. He said, peace be upon you, I shall ask my Lord for forgiveness for you. And thereafter he left the home. And here there is another lesson. The Mufassirun have written that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said, Salamun alayk, peace be upon you. Thereafter he said, he promised his father that I shall ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah azza wa jalla to forgive me. However, this is an accepted fact that one cannot ask and seek forgiveness for one who disbelieves in Allah. Because this person does not even attest his belief in Allah. So one cannot ask forgiveness for a person who disbelieves in Allah. So how is Ibrahim alayhi salam here asking forgiveness for his father who is a disbeliever? And later on we find in the Quran that Ibrahim alayhi salam did ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then later on, the Mufassirun have written, when it became apparent to Ibrahim alayhi salam that his father was on the path of dhalalah, or was on the path of doom, he had gone astray, was on the path of destruction and of disbelief and rejection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibrahim alayhi salam stopped his asking of forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which we find in the surah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ. That there is a great example for you in the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam and those who were with him. When they established a clear difference between themselves and the disbelievers, they established a wall of separation. Thus we free ourselves from your actions. We wash our hands from your belief, from your ascribing partners, from your denial of faith, from your disbelief in the oneness of the Creator. And we separate ourselves from you and from your society. They were living within the society, but they separated themselves from the society. And they said that our relationship is only that of da'wah and of calling and of necessities only. Apart from that, we have no relationship. Which is why when the Prophet, we find the many of the Prophets, Lut alayhi salam, his wife did not believe. Nuh alayhi salam, his son did not believe. Ibrahim alayhi salam, his father did not believe. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our own beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his uncle did not believe. And these Prophets, when they said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Dawu Allah, forgive my family, forgive my wife, my son, my father, my uncle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in reply to them said, that laysa min ahlik, that they are not from your family. This is the wife, the son, the father, the uncle. Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, Laysa min ahlik, they are not from your family. From this we learn that those people who profess the faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the believers are the family, and those who do not believe, there may be a physical relationship, they may be the means of conception in the world, there may be some blood ties, but the real family in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the family of believers, is the family of mu'minun and of those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Oh Allah, do not embarrass me, do not degrade me. On the day of Qiyamah, in a hadith narrated by Sahih al-Bukhari, Ibrahim alayhi salam will come on the day of Qiyamah in front of Allah azza wa jal. And at that time, his father Azar will come, and he will say to Ibrahim, that, Oh Ibrahim, I shall follow you today. Oh Ibrahim, I shall follow you today. Remember, after death, forgiveness will not be accepted. One cannot bring iman and belief after death. On the day of Qiyamah, Azar is coming to Ibrahim alayhi salam. He will say, Oh son, I will follow you today. I'll follow you. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he will say to Allah, Oh Allah, remember I made the supplication. Do not embarrass and degrade me. And what greater embarrassment and degradation can they be than my father being sent to hell? What greater embarrassment can there be? And he will turn to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to Ibrahim alayhi salam, that look at who is at your side. This is a narration of Sahih al-Bukhari. Ibrahim alayhi salam will turn to his side and he will see that instead of his father there is a hyena. And so Ibrahim alayhi salam will turn away disgusted and walk away. And thereafter Allah will pick the father Azab and will put him in the fire of hell. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding those who disbelieve, Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَظَلِ. That they are like animals, they in fact they are worse than animals. They are even more lost in their ways and in their path than animals. And so here on the day of Qiyamah, When Azar will come to Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Ibrahim alayhi salam will ask Allah, then Allah will show this divide between belief and disbelief. And the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which Ibrahim alayhi salam professed. Every prophet which came, including our own beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The verses are in the Quran and in the books of history. Every prophet was instructed by Allah that follow and stay within the group of the believers. Stay within the company, the group and the nation of believers. Stay with the believers. كُونُوا مَعَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Stay with the believers. The Prophet ﷺ was also told, he stayed within his companions, Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Every prophet stayed within their companions. Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, all the prophets, they all stayed within their companions, within the believers. But the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, while he was wherever he was, because Ibrahim alayhi salam then hijrah and migrated many a times in his life. He was born in Babel, which is Babylon. Thereafter he migrated to Misr, Egypt, from there to Iraq, from there to Hijaz. Ibrahim alayhi salam's life was full of migration. But wherever Ibrahim alayhi salam went, there was only one person or two people accepting Islam. There was no group of people. Ibrahim alayhi salam in Babylon, there was only his nephew Lut alayhi salam. When he went to Misr, there was only his wife Sarah alayhi salam. When he went to Hijaz in Arabia, there was only his wife Hajar alayhi salam. And thereafter his son Ismail and Ishaq alayhi salam were born. But whatever you see, there was only one person with him, either his nephew or his wife or his son. And so that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, he gives Ibrahim alayhi salam a title which was given to no other prophet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً. That Ibrahim alayhi salam as an individual, as himself, was a nation. Every prophet was told, stay with your nation, the nation of believers. With regards to Ibrahim alayhi salam, they were no people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said Ibrahim alayhi salam was the nation of believers. Such was the great status of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And therefore it is a lesson for us today also, that we stay within the nation and within the company of the believers. Our 24 hours should be all the time within the company of believers. Our lives should always be in the company of believers. As much time as we can, our friend circle, our close associates, they should all be believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our relationship with those who disbelieve is a relationship of da'wah and of calling towards the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those of relationship of necessity. And all the times we interact with those who disbelieve, it should be an interaction of da'wah and of call to the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and da'wah towards Islam. All our actions should portray the truthfulness and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we learn that our community and our close associates should be those who believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the believers. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, his message of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which resounded at the time only between two of his close associates, which then manifested itself between the prophets, which would come later, which is why Ibrahim alayhi salam was given the title of Abul Anbiya. Every prophet which came on the surface of this earth after Ibrahim alayhi salam was from the progeny of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Apart from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every prophet from Musa to Isa, from Yusuf alayhi salam, Yaqub alayhi salam, all the way to Isa alayhi salam, were from his son Ishaq alayhi salam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was from the progeny of Ismail alayhi salam. So this is another title bestowed to Ibrahim alayhi salam of Abu al-Anbiya. Thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him another title. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said he is from أُولُو الْعَظْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. A specific, exact English translation cannot be found. However, these are five great prophets who were chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of these five elite prophets from the galaxy of prophets, One of them was Ibrahim alayhi salam. And thereafter, on the subject of Tawheed, another title of Ibrahim alayhi salam, Al-Muwahid al-A'ram, the greatest monotheist to come on the surface of this earth. Which is why we find that whenever we talk about Ibrahim alayhi salam, we are reminded of his sacrifices on one side and his submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on the other side, we find many instances in the Quran where Allah Azza wa Jal, he talks about the understanding of Ibrahim alayhi salam, or the oneness of Allah, where Ibrahim alayhi salam, in the form of his debate with his nation, he came out and he saw the stars shining in the sky, and he said that these are my Lord, these must be the Creator, look how bright they are shining. But once the moon came and the moon outshone the stars, so Ibrahim alayhi salam said, maybe this is my Lord, it is outshining the stars by many times. But when the moon went and the sun rose, he said that the moon cannot be my Lord. If the moon can go, the moon can disappear, and something which is greater and shines much more brightly and its light is much more bright than the moon, then this must be my Lord. And he said that the sun must be my Lord. But at the end of the day, when the sun set and the world was once again covered with darkness, Ibrahim alayhi salam said, and the sun can neither be my Lord. My Lord is not one who comes and goes. He's not one whose light extinguishes. The Lord is not the one who disappears. The Lord is not the one who cannot be found. The Lord is not the one who cannot help the creation. The Lord is not the one which disappears and with whom one can lose contact. No, the Lord is the one who is the creator of the heavens and the earth, the creator of the stars, the moon and the sun, the creator of the planets, the creator of you and I, the creator of everything which is in existence. And this creator is one, and there is only one being, and there can be no partner. And Ibrahim alayhi salam exclaimed this to his nation, but his nation still did not believe. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, at the age of 16, he moved away from his village, from his town, because of his father sending him away. And the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is denied by the polytheists, to refute the polytheists is very easy. Ibrahim alayhi salam done it in his lifetime, whether they accept or not, on the basis of evidence, on the basis of rational reason and explanation, it is very easy to refute and rebunk the theory and the polytheistic ideas. A greater evil which has come into society today is one of atheism, the complete rejection and denial of a God and of a supreme being. Which is why Ibrahim alayhi salam's message is even more important today, where he said, La ilaha illallah. He said, there is none worthy of worship except Allah. Yes, we deny everything else, but we have to accept that there is one being who is worthy to worship. There is one being who created everything. The policy of those who are atheists and deny and reject any creator, they believe that everything has come into existence through matter and movement. That there is matter and there is movement, and random movements of matter have brought into existence the universe. And they believe that there is no need for a creator. They reject the idea of a creator. They say this is something made up by the human mind. And they say that no, it was random movements of matter which were not created by any being, which were not created by any individual. They just existed. And through these random movements, the earth, the sun, the stars, the moon, the rivers, the land, the earth, the animals, the trees, the humans came into existence. And a story which comes to mind is one of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala. A group of atheists at the time, the atheists were at a peak at his time, and they came to have a discussion with Imam Abu Hanifa. So Imam Abu Hanifa, they set a time, for example, they said, okay, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, 3 o'clock in the afternoon we shall meet at a certain place, Now in Baghdad there's a river which runs in the middle. So we shall meet at this place in Baghdad. And at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, for example, and this is a time which was set for the debate. So Ibrahim alayhi salam said, fine. Now the atheist at the time, who was the leader of the atheists, he arrived and he took his place on the stage. He came early. They said, this is going to be the decision between faith and no faith. Like the sociologists of this century have said, God or no God. And the masses which turned out were huge. Every atheist came, and the people of Iraq came in huge numbers. And a huge conference and huge gathering was gathered. And the atheist was there early. And he arrived and he was waiting. And the time came, 2:45, 5:10, 3 o'clock, and Imam Abu Hanifa is not present. Said, okay, maybe he's way late in the traffic. Let's wait a bit. 3:05, 3:10, 3:15, 3:30, Imam Abu Hanifa is not present. So the atheist now starts mocking the people. The believers are getting worried, and he's now mocking them. He's saying, look at your Imam. He knows he's going to lose. He knows there's no God. That's why he's coming late. He's scared. He's chickened out, and he's not going to come for the debate. They wait a little longer, and suddenly the distance they see coming from the river, a couple of people walking. As they come close, they see Imam Hanifa rahimahullah with a couple of his students. And it's coming closer. As soon as they come, this person says that, look at you, you give me a time of 3 o'clock and you come so late. What is wrong? Can't you keep your time? Imam Hanifa said, have you finished talking? He said, yeah, okay. He said, listen to my excuse. He said, okay, what's your excuse? He said, I was coming. Now, as you know, I need to cross the river because I live on the other side of Baghdad. So I came to the river, and usually in those times there used to be ships and boats which used to make people cross the river. Imam Hanifa said, I was coming, I waited on the side, but there were no ships. No ship came, and I was waiting, no boat, nobody to take me across the river. Suddenly there was a tree on the side. The tree uprooted itself, came out of the ground. It shed the leaves. The bark came off, it cut itself into planks, the planks joined together, it then went into the river. I just stepped inside, the piece of plank came in the middle, the leaves joined together make a sail. I stepped inside, it sailed across the river to the other side, it moored by itself on the bank, and I stepped off and I came here. And my luggage came on by itself, it went off by itself also. So this person turned to the people and he said, look, you call this your Imam, you say him Imam al-A'zam, he is the leader, and what a foolish man. How foolish is your Imam? He says that a tree became a boat, crossed the river, loaded and unloaded the goods by itself. How foolish. Imam Abu Hanifa said, I am foolish because I believe a tree can't turn into a boat and cross the river, and you are very intelligent because you believe the whole earth can become by itself. This person was stunned. This is a great answer. If any atheist comes, an example, if you take a book, it's got great calligraphy inside. The atheist will say that the beautiful calligraphy in this book happened because there were random movements of matter. And the matter randomly moved. And remember, matter, they believe and accept also, it has no brain, no intellect. It cannot hear, it cannot see, it is deaf, dumb and blind. And so this deaf, dumb and blind matter with random movements made this beautiful calligraphy. It is obvious that such a theory will be rejected, even they will reject it. And they will say, no, it must be some artist who has done this calligraphy and writing. Another example. You have a watch. If you were to follow the theory of the atheist, then you say that the mechanisms in the watch, there was matter, this matter with random movement, which cannot be conceived, is deaf, dumb and blind matter, moved, it made this mechanism, and the mechanism follows the time, and the watch came into being. This is how the theory of atheism. But a person with intellect would say, no, the watch was made by a professional watchmaker. Another example, the watch There was a man, he's deaf, dumb and blind with no brain. He's mentally disabled and handicapped, and he made the watch. Even then everyone rejects. So here there's two reasons to reject. Number one, a man who is deaf, dumb and blind, he cannot make a watch. Everyone accepts. Secondly, matter with random movements cannot make a watch come into being. Therefore, how can the whole system of the world, the earth, the planets, the movement, the going round of the sun, the movement of the earth, the planets, the stars, the whole system of the universe, how can it have come to being through random movements of matter? It is not possible. Another answer to the atheist, Imam Malik rahimahullah, he gives an example, and he said that look at the human race. Look at the human race. The human race, every single individual has a face. But on the face of every individual, he has eyes, he has a nose, he has a mouth, he has ears. Then inside his mouth, the intricate details of the mouth, the skin, the nose, eyes, etc. But that every single individual is different. Every individual is different. No two fingerprints in the world are the same. From the time of Adam alayhi salam to the last man. And they are all different. The view of the atheist is that random movements of matter, made such unique individuals come into existence. Whereas it has to be an established fact that matter, which is deaf, dumb and blind and without intellect, with random movements, cannot make such unique individuals. It is absolutely impossible. And therefore one must accept and come to a conclusion that there is a Lord and a Creator. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he gives an example of the mulberry tree. He says the mulberry tree, when it grows, when the silkworm eats from this tree, remember this tree is the same. The smell, the taste, the leaves, the look, everything else, the mulberry tree is the same. The silkworm eats it, it produces silk. The bee eats from it produces honey. The sheep eats from it produces dung. When another animal eats from it produces something else. If it was matter, then it should be that all of them produce the same thing. Because it is one system. This proves that when each different animal is eating from the same thing, and the process of digestion happens in each animal, and yet the outcome is different, it proves that there must be a creator who has designed each one for a unique purpose. And therefore, it has to be affirmed that there is none worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La ilaha illallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the supreme, omnipotent creator and being who exists and created everything which is in being today. And they also have a theory which they deny everything which they cannot see. They deny everything which cannot be seen. Nowadays we type on a computer, the words appear on the screen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are there any hufaz here? Any here hufaz of the Quran? Raise your hand. Okay. And if you look at these hufaz, everyone here accepts they got the Quran in their heart. They got the Quran in their heart, right? I ask all of you, open the chest of this hafiz. Tear it open. Open his brain. Cut it into pieces. Cut his heart to pieces. Tell me if you can find the Quran written anywhere. You cannot find the Quran, but you say that it exists in his heart. So why do you deny the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you cannot see? Take the brain. Everyone accepts that people have brain and intellect. Until today, has anyone ever seen their own brain? Anyone ever seen their own organs inside their body? No. But you accept that you have a brain because you see the effects of the brain. In the same way, you do not see the Creator Allah. You do not see Ar-Rahman. But you see the effects of the creation of Ar-Rahman Therefore, just like you cannot deny the Quran even though you have not seen, you cannot deny the brain even though you have not seen, you cannot deny Rahman even if you haven't seen. And just not seeing something is not a reason to deny. And the conference which took place on the 15th of October, he's an atheist and he's a scientist. He also, after the conference, said it is impossible to deny the existence of a God. It is impossible to deny the existence of a God. No scientist can prove that a God does not exist. It is not possible. Yes, because of the reason I explained, that they cannot see or they cannot find it tangible, so they deny it. But they cannot prove that a God does not exist. So they have to accept this much, that there is a possibility. When you accept there is a possibility and your reason for denial is based on no evidence, then how and why do you reject and not believe? This is the message of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that he was al-muwahid al-a'zam, the greatest monotheist, and he proclaimed the oneness of Allah azza wa jal to the entire world and to the entire people. Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he went out later and he gave the da'wah to his people and the people turned against him. Remember, he was still young, teenager, and he was by himself, which we need to learn today, that the people who will change society, the people who will bring reform into society, are the youth, which is a lesson we take from the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam. When the youth will stand up and rise, and they will come up to turn the tide of society. They will turn the people away from polytheism to monotheism. They will turn people away from disbelief to belief. They will turn people away from rejection to acceptance. They will turn people away from denial into the submission of the one Lord. They will turn people away from this obedience into obedience. Then this is the burden of the youth of society. If you look at the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also, you will find that apart from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, at the time of Hijrah, there was not a single companion who was over the age of 40. All of them were under the age of 40, and most of them were in the 20s or less or younger. And when they did Hijrah, and we find the stories in history, whenever we find interesting moments, we find that the people who played the greater role and who played a very significant role were always the youth. Just like Ibrahim alayhi salam at the age of 16 was calling his nation towards one deity and one Lord. And at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the people who joined him were the youth. They supported his message. They accepted his message. They helped him to convey this message. And the people who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appointed were also youth. They were the most strict strictly adhering to the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah azza wa jal. So this is a responsibility for the youth. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam, he talks to the people and he tells them that believe in one Allah. They say, shall we turn away from what our forefathers have been following for so many years? And Ibrahim alayhi salam said that no, but you and your fathers were astray. Your forefathers were also astray. He's saying them straight and open. He's not beating around the bush. He's not trying to play mind games or be politically correct. No, he says straight, you and your fathers were astray in following idols. The people were shocked. A 16-year-old boy is coming into the community, telling all the elders, and he's saying to them, you're all astray, and your dad, and your grandfather, and all your fathers, and all your generations that came before, they're all astray. He said to him, are you playing with us? Are you joking? Are you mocking? Are you playing around? He said, no. I'm saying the truth. You, all of you are astray. And there is only one Lord and you cannot ascribe any partners to him. Why do you worship these idols? The people rejected his call. So he said that, I swear, when you go away, when you turn away from here, Because he used to have a time of the year where they used to go and celebrate. They would all go out of the city and they would celebrate, and they would have where they would worship their lords and they would do the celebration. He said, when you go, I am going to break every single one of your idols. Maybe some people heard, maybe they didn't, they didn't want to pay much attention to him. The day came, all the people went. Ibrahim alayhi salam got an axe. He went to the place where all the idols were stored. He made an excuse. He said, I'm feeling ill. Not physically ill, but sick with their polytheism, sick with the rejection of the oneness of Allah. And he went, and he with the axe, he broke all the idols apart from the biggest one. And then he got the axe and he hung it on the shoulder of the biggest idol. And then he went back home. When all the people returned, he went straight to there to worship the idol. And they went and they found all of them broken. So they said, what's happened here? Who's done this? So then, one of the people there, they must have heard what Ibrahim alayhi salam said, or they must have heard his message. So they said that we've heard of someone called Ibrahim. Now listen to what they said. One is, you know Ibrahim? And one is, some guy called Ibrahim. There are two things here. The first one, when you say, you know Ibrahim, he's known. When you say some guy, some person called Ibrahim, that means he's not even known. Ibrahim alayhi salam was not even known in his society, yet he stood up and gave the message. So here they said, we know. They call him some person and his name is Ibrahim or something, or saying something about his idols. So they said, okay, call him. So Ibrahim alayhi salam was called. He came. They said, did you break these idols? What did you do with our idols? Did you break them? He said, no, it wasn't me. Ask the big one. He's got the axe. All he had to say was this. Straight away they looked amongst themselves and they were embarrassed. They knew, and they had to accept from their heart, that what he's saying is correct. That the idols, the deaf, dumb, blind, they're made out of stone, we made them in our own hands. They don't give us food, they don't give us drink. When we put food for them to eat, when we go at night, the priest comes and eats it, or the mice do. They can't do anything. The idols, they can't bring any benefit to us. We supplicate to them, we know they don't help us. And so they realize, suddenly dawned on them. So this was a good thought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's another lesson here, which I'm coming to. This was a good thought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That they realized that, wait a minute, what he is saying is correct. These idols are not going to benefit us. But straight away shaitan came and attacked. Which is what happens to us also. We get a good thought of doing something good and some good action, but then a waswasa of shaitan comes. A thought of shaitan comes. And he says, no, not now, later. You're still young. We've got time, maybe later. So again, same thing happened to these people, this nation. They thought that, wait a minute, he's not correct, but then the thought came from shaitan. No, help your idols. You've been worshipping these, your forefathers, everyone's been worshipping these for ages. And now he's come and broken them. Who does he think he is? A 16-year-old turning against the whole society? So straight away, shaitan overpowered what they were thinking, and overcame their good thought. We must not let this happen to us. When a good thought comes, the scholars have written, and the scholars have taught us that whenever a good thought comes, straight away act it out. So we're in the masjid, we've come for salah. We pray Isha, and after Isha, a thought comes. But you know what? Let me just pray two rakat nafil today also. Don't say, oh no, I'm a bit tired. No, just pray. Because it may be that you may not get the opportunity again. So as soon as a good thought comes, just pray. Don't say tomorrow or later on. No. You got a thought, you're sitting at home, you're feeling a bit bored. And he goes, oh, maybe shall I pick up a book and read some Quran? Shall I pick up a book and read something about Islam? Shall I read the Quran? The thought comes, not put it aside and say later. Get the Quran, pick up the book and read and recite the Quran. Do not leave it for later. Because if you say later, then Shaytan will come and say, no, why didn't you watch something? Why didn't you watch a program? Oh, you haven't watched this movie. So this is a very important lesson we should learn here. That the nation, they understood, but then Shaytan overcame and overpowered them. And so the nation again, they said, turned against Ibrahim alayhi salam. Then the leader of the time, Namrud, what did he do? When Ibrahim alayhi salam was telling them, no, you are wrong, why are you swearing at our idols? People nowadays say, don't say they are wrong. No, they are wrong. You have to accept. Ibrahim alayhi salam done the same thing. Every prophet came to his nation, and if there was a wrong in society, he proclaimed the wrong openly. And this is the job of a believer. The believer must openly proclaim the wrongs in society. He must not hide from the truth, because this is a sign of a coward. And a believer is not a coward. A believer does not hide from the truth. So Ibrahim alayhi salam proclaimed the truth. And this is from the whole life of all the prophets. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, he faced the most severe test. A fire was made, and the fire was so great, it is written in the books of history, a bird was to be flying over, it would come down as a barbecue chicken. And this was the extent of the heat of the fire. Ibrahim alayhi salam was thrown into the fire, and his belief in Allah, look at his belief in Allah. When he was thrown into the fire, Jibreel alayhi salam came down with the angels. And he said that Allah has sent me. Allah has sent me, and if you want, I can provide for you here. Ibrahim alayhi salam said, no, my Lord is enough for me. I don't need no angels also. You have been sent by Allah, I don't need them. I don't need you. Allah will suffice for me. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, and he ordered the fire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the fire himself. And he said, كُونُوا بَرْضًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ Ibrahim. Become peaceful and become cool for my servant Ibrahim alayhi salam. And the Mufassirun have written that the command of Allah is so great, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had not added at the end, ala Ibrahim, if Allah Azza wa Jalla had just said, كُونُوا بَرْضًا وَسَلَامًا, then until the day of Qiyamah, the fire would have become cool and would have become peaceful and would not have been able to warm our homes. Such is the power of the command of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Allah, by saying ala Ibrahim, then mercy on Ibrahim alayhi salam, by making it cool for him, and then mercy on us, by making it warm for us so that we can warm our homes. And Ibrahim alayhi salam faced all these trials and tribulations. And remember, whenever trials and tribulations come in our lives also, we must stand firm against these trials and tribulations. And we must always be in the forefront of giving da'wah towards Islam. The dictionary definition of da'wah is general, to Muslims and non-Muslims. That means just to call them, so you can call someone towards salah, call someone towards the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, call the fellow Muslims towards good deeds, and call them towards the worship of Allah. Tell them to go away from the disobedience. But technically da'wah is for those who disbelieve, to call them towards Islam and the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the book of the Quran, the message of the Quran, and the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And eventually, as the speaker before we mentioned, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the lessons of the submission from Ibrahim alayhi salam, and Allah azza wa jal said, فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا, when they both submitted, and in the same way where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, and both of the opinion that the term Islam and Muslim stem from Ibrahim alayhi salam, because of his steadfastness and his submission to Allah azza wa jal. And submission, we find nowadays people talk about, no, it's all in the heart. It's all in the heart. It doesn't matter on the outside. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you look at what he mentions with regards to Ibrahim alayhi salam, and when he talks about the submission of external bodily acts also. Submission is to bring iman by the heart, and your body to submit to the commands of Allah. It is not sufficient just to be in the heart. So to get an envelope, put the letter inside, write the address on the envelope, and seal the envelope, and tell you to go and put it in the postbox. And the envelope is clear, it has no writing. You will tell me, no, write the address on top. I say, no, it's all inside. You're going to say it's not going to go there, because it has to be on the outside also. In the same way, the Islam is not sufficient just to be on the inside, it has to be on the outside also. So you have the correct address to go to for that. So Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he submitted, they were all bodily and physically actions. First, he did hijrah. He left his wife, he left his son, he left his people, he left his father, he left his family. Thereafter, he went to sacrifice his son, he made the Kaaba. He done all these acts, and they were in submission, bodily, physical, external submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as well as bringing iman by the heart, we must bring our external submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at our features. He does not look at how we look, what race or what background we are from. He does not look at ethnicity. He does not look at the physical makeup of an individual. But he looks at the heart, what is in the heart, and he looks at the actions of an individual. Therefore, we must correct our heart and our thoughts, our mind, and at the same time, we must correct our actions and our external exemplification of our belief and submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are many lessons, and there are many other lessons also in the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam, which you will find in the many books of tafasir, and the books of history, and the books of ahadith. From today, let us take the message of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which we learn from Ibrahim alayhi salam, his method and dedication to da'wah and calling people towards the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his staying within the community of believers and his separation from the disbelievers, and also his submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give myself and all of us present here and all the Muslims guidance to follow the way and the millah of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in accordance with the teaching of Allah azza wa jal. Ameen. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.